So we proceed with our morning session. It's a great pleasure to introduce Jan Sobelman from Kansas State University, who is going to enlighten us on homomorphic polar theory. Jan?
Thank you, Lyudmila, for your optimism. I hope it will be enlightening talk. All right, so I start with a reminder on the general Riemann-Hilbert correspondence and its relation to the holomorphic polar theory, which Maxim briefly mentioned. He mentioned holomorphic Fluer theory, but not the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. So without the details, if we have a complex symplectic manifold, then under some assumptions, one can associate to it two, in fact, analytic family of categories depending on the parameter H bar. One is the Foucaille category, for which the real part of the holomorphic form, well, rescaled by h-bar, is a real symplectic form, and the imaginary part is a B-field. This is one category. And another, it's a category of holomorphic DQ, deformation quantization modules. This is a notation for this category. And to simplify everything, let's think that this category is a category of certain modules over the quantized algebra of this complex symplectic manifold. Now, the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, a general one proposed by Maxim and myself, and it's conjectural in general, says that these two categories are equivalent.
Jan, sorry, I think you stay on the first page. You don't move pages at all.
All right, so anyway, this is what I've just told you, that there is a general Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, which roughly speaking says that the Foucaille category of the complex symplectic manifold M, this is a holomorphic symplectic structure, is equivalent to the category of holonomic DQ modules on the same manifold. One can think of this statement as of a categorical version of the comparison isomorphism of Betti and the Ramka homology, which was implicit in Maxim's talk. So just imagine that on the Deram side, you have some kind of cohomology, and on the Betti side, you replace chain complexes by the Morse complexes. So in holomorphic Fluer theory, we study complex symplectic manifolds and Fluer complexes of holomorphic Lagrangian subvarieties, say submanifolds. So here, the dependence on the Planck constant, this complex parameter h bar, is crucial because the Fluer differential is non-trivial only for special values of h bar, like Maxim explained it in the case of holomorphic Morse-Novikov theory. So then the Fluer homology groups, say for a pair of Lagrangians, they form say a local system on the circle or on the puncture complex line. And there is a Stokes phenomenon. So when the H bar crosses the special values of H bar, then the groups, we have Stokes isomorphisms of something on the left and something on the right of a particular Stokes ray. More precise statement of the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence requires too many details to explain in 1 hour. For example, a partial compactification of the holomorphic symplectic manifold and many other things. So it's indeed interesting that the project, which is more than 7 years old, exists only online in the series of videos of talks and lecture courses. And this is one of the references to my talk at the Institute for Advanced Study. Today I will try to be not very technical. So I will assume that whatever I am talking about, these things can be defined under some assumptions. All right, and in any case, today I'm going to discuss kind of a very simple version of holomorphic Fourier theory. When the symplectic manifold is a cotangent bundle to a complex manifold, for example, to smooth complex affine algebraic variety. And I will be interested essentially for the most part of my talk in the Fourier complex of two holomorphic Lagrangians. One is zero sectioned and another is a graph of the differential of some function on X. So, and as Maxim explained, you can replace L1 by the graph of the holomorphic closed one form, and you will see some interesting things as well. So, as I mentioned, this presence of the Planck constant of this complex parameter H bar is important, and it can be easily incorporated by rescaling F by the Planck constant. All right, so why this special case? Because it controls the geometry and analysis of the exponential integral I of H, integral of exponent of H divided by H bar. We should pick up some top degree holomorphic volume form in order to write down the integral and choose an integration cycle. And there is some ambiguity in both choices, but let's assume that we fix this holomorphic volume form and fix, say, the class of cycles. I don't know, like, in what will follow, it will be essentially integer combinations of symbols, but in general, it's kind of integer combination of real-oriented submanifolds of X. Okay, and this is the main object for today's talk. So my talk splits in two parts. In the first one, I will explain the finite dimensional story. And in the second one, I will explain a proposal for the Feynman integral, for the infinite dimensional version of the same integral. So, but now we are in the finite dimensional situation. So then we can define two type of cohomology. So one is a twisted Deram cohomology, which is hypercohomology of the complex of differential forms with a twisted Deram differential, and the Betti cohomology, which already appeared in Maxim's talk. We consider the relative cohomology of the total space with respect to the fiber of F, taken very, very far, very close to infinity, I would say. So close that the homology group stabilizes. And so we can take the dual one. Actually, it's written, there is a typo here because what is written, it's Betti homology, but cohomology can be defined when you raise this in a completely similar way, just basically dual to the homology. All right, so one can make, introducing this H bar, you can make either of the cohomology group into the sheaf of graded abelian groups on the punctured complex line. When all the definitions, in particular this appropriate compactification of X is chosen, because X is non-compact, otherwise there are no functions. Then in the end, we have a comparison isomorphism that global Deram cohomology groups are isomorphic to the global Bethe cohomology groups. So it's completely parallel to the story when there is no function f at all. Then we have just integrals, say, of rational functions or cycles, which are periods. And so by analogy, we should think of this integral I of h bar as an exponential period, which means the pairing of the closed Durham class with some Bethe homology class, which means the dual to the closed Bethe cohomology class. All right. You can. The only problem is whether I can go back. Yeah, I can. All right.
Is the comparison isomorphism in this case, is that something which I can read about in a document, or is that still a conjecture?
It's a good question. It's not difficult. Well, first of all right. No, you cannot, because the version which I need, it depends on the compactification X bar, and compactification is not trivial at all. So you see, we are writing a paper on that, and hopefully it will be ready this year. Then you can read the details. Yeah. But currently I'm not sure that you can find it in the published literature. Yeah. Now, basically, on this slide, I just repeat what I said before. So we have two Lagrangians, yeah. And for generic value of h bar, there are no pseudo holomorphic disks with respect to an auxiliary almost complex structure, which is compatible with the real part of the holomorphic form, the kind of conventional compatibility condition. We can look for pseudo holomorphic disks. For generic H bar, there are no such disks, but for special directions, special values of argument of H bar, it's called stoked direction, such disks do appear. And so, in terms of the exponential integrals, when we cross such a Stokes ray, then this exponential integral jumps. And these jumps are described by the wall crossing formulas of Chakotay-Wafa type, which I will recall later in the talk. But before I go to kind of more concrete formulas, so you can see it in down to earth terms, let me mention a few other general things. One is the local versions of Durham and Bethe cohomology. Instead of the pair which consists of our complex manifold and a pre-image of, say, minus infinity of the point which is very close to infinity on the negative x-axis, we can consider its local version. We take the critical value zj, say, assume that they are all kind of, well, I will assume later that it's a Morse critical, Morse function with isolated Morse critical points and different critical values, zj. So take a small disk about the critical value, and on the boundary, take a point, which I denoted as minus one, minus infinity I. And so that's a local analog of this global pair x f minus one infinity, and you can repeat basically all the definitions like twisted Durham cohomology and twisted Bethe cohomology. Then you have not only global Durham and Bethe cohomology, but also local. And there is a bunch of comparison isomorphisms, actually four of them, two by two. Betty global to local, Durham global to local, and similar Betty global to Durham global and Betty local to Durham local. Well, Betty and Durham, it's roughly speaking, you integrate some form over some cycle. This is an isomorphism. What is more interesting that this four isomorphism on the cohomology level, they can be upgraded to the categorical level. So we have two holomorphic Lagrangian submanifolds, zero section L0 and L1, the graph of the differential. And we can consider a small neighborhood, tubular neighborhood of their union. And then we can repeat again with many details, which I don't have time to explain now. We can repeat the definition of the, say, Fukaya category. And easier, we can repeat the definition of the category of holonomic decoy modules. And so what is interesting that we'll get, again, four categories, like this FH bar, it's a global category, but there is a local version of it, FH bar local. It's the direct sum over all critical values of the local versions of Fukaya categories. And similarly, we have a global category of holonomic decoy modules, and we have a local version of them. And there are four equivalences of categories, which I will display on the maybe next, maybe in two slides. And these four equivalences of local and global categories, they just categorify the isomorphism at the level of cohomology. For example, the isomorphism of Durham global to Betty global to Durham global, it's just categorified to the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, which I mentioned at the very first slide. And similarly, we have a local Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, which sits in the small neighborhood of the union of my holomorphic Lagrangians. Now here it's an illustration of the locality. So say L alpha, say L0, L beta is L1. And so I consider small neighborhood, and you can treat their union as a kind of a Lagrangian skeleton of this neighborhood. This is a slide for the definition of local Fukaya category. This is a slide which illustrates these four categorical equivalences, which just what I've said, Fukaya local to global. It's equivalence of something which sits on the whole symplectic manifold and something which sits in the small neighborhood. And here it's important that the direction H bar is not the Stokes one. The local Fukaya category, basically, there are no, it's something which essentially lives over integer numbers. There are no pseudo holomorphic disks locally between L0 and L1 generically. So then outside, it basically means that this embedding does not give any new information. As you can see, this 1, 2, 3, 4, two of the equivalences, namely 2 and 4, which involves some local stuff, they live over formal power series only. And moreover, we have to invert the Planck constant. This is a familiar phenomenon in deformation quantization, and we will see it again later on. So, but again, we have Fukaya local to global, holonomic local to global, and global Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, which mean global Fukaya to global holonomic, and the local version of 3 prime. So it's the same as 3, but at the local level, which, as you see, it holds only over Laurent series. All right. So as I said, these categorical equivalences, they imply the isomorphism at the level of cohomology groups, and I give an illustration of that, how to go from categories to cohomology groups, and why Fukaya indeed categorifies the Betti side of the story. So if I take, again, as before, L0 to be the zero section, L1 to be the graph of the differential, and take the Fukaya category of the cotangent bundle, and take X groups between L0 and L1 in that Fukaya category, then it's the same as the relative cohomology group, which is a Betti cohomology group, as long as we take Z to be on the ray through this complex number H bar, sufficiently large number. Okay.
Jan, I have a question.
Yep.
You can prove this even when the L's are not transverse.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, you should look for the sheaf of vanishing cycles, as I believe Maxim mentioned, or he should mention. Yeah, let's assume, okay, in general, in holomorphic Floyer theory, there is a kind of a lot of generalizations of this toy model. In particular, Lagrangians do not have to be smooth. And also there are some things can be said if they are not, if they are holomorphic, but not transversal. But okay, let me just for simplicity assume that this intersection is clean, that they intersect transversally. All right. Mm. And now let's indeed make all that very explicit and make the connection with exponential integrals, this Floyer stuff and holonomic D-module stuff. So let's assume that our manifold is scalar and the function f is Morse with, say, different critical values. Take theta to be a certain direction of the ray, argument of H bar. Then there is a notion of a thimble. Probably it's better to draw the picture. I believe that everyone knows what the thimble is. It's a Lagrangian submanifold, which is formed by gradient lines of the Keller metric, gradient lines outcoming of the critical point xi. And it's the same as Hamiltonian trajectories for the imaginary part. So to be kind of, if you like to read in words, this is what it is. We take this C infinity function f, take its gradient trajectories outcoming of the critical point xi. And equivalently, you can take the as a Hamiltonian imaginary part and look for the Hamiltonian trajectory. So this, it will be the same. So the union of all these form a thimble. The projection is a ray outcoming from the critical value Zi corresponding to this critical point. All right. And let's assume in addition that let's choose the holomorphic volume form wall on X. So then we can integrate. And so with every critical point, or with every critical value, if you like, because in one-to-one correspondence, but by my assumptions on this slide, I can associate an elementary integral, sort of a local input to the global integral, namely the integral over this symbol. So then the general integral will be the linear combination of such. And I assume, as I mentioned, but it's written here, that I assume that the critical values are in generic position, which means that the Stokes ray contains no more than two different critical values. And so I can order them by their proximity to the vertex. So on the set of indices, there is a linear order. And now this Picard-Lefschetz or whatever, Chikwetti-Waffa, it depends, are you a mathematician or a physicist? The H bar, the parameter H bar crosses the Stokes ray, which contains two critical points, Zi and Zj, and I is smaller than J, then the integral gets changed by this very simple formula. And here Nij is an integer number. It's a number of gradient trajectories of this function between critical points Xi and Xj corresponding to these critical values. So Maxim recalled you that since F is holomorphic Morse, so all critical points have the same index, and generically there are no gradient trajectories, but for special values of H bar, for special directions, namely for Stokes directions, such gradient lines appear. And the number of these gradient lines is the same as the number of pseudo-virtual, if you like, number of pseudo-holomorphic disks stretched between the zero section and the graph of the differential, which I mentioned before. So this, if you'd like, correspond to the wall crossing formula on the moduli space of pseudo-holomorphic disks. All right. Now I am approaching to the resurgence, and for that, let me rescale these elementary exponential integrals. And this rescaling, this rescaled integrals has an expansion, Taylor expansion in H bar. This rescaled or modified integrals also have the wall crossing, they enjoy the wall crossing formulas when we cross the Stokes direction. They a little bit different, but follows from what was written on the previous slide. And now we can form a vector, take all possible critical points, all possible critical values. For each critical point, I have the integral over the corresponding symbol modified. So I have a vector valued function on the punctured complex line. And so this vector valued function, it enjoys some jumping property along the Stokes rays, which means that it can be described as a solution of certain Riemann-Hilbert problem. So it's pure analytical question. So in abstract terms, this means that we are looking for the a collection of function on C star minus the union of Stokes rays. And each of these has a formal asymptotic expansion as known Taylor series as h bar goes to zero. And when we cross the Stokes ray, so this collection satisfies the following jumping property. So this is the jumping property on the Stokes ray Sij, which contains two critical values, Zi and Zj. So this is analytic statement of the problem, and geometrically this means that this collection forms a section, holomorphic section of a vector bundle on C star of H bar. And if I consider, for example, the Stokes sector, the sector bound by two Stokes rays, then inside of this Stokes sector, each of the coordinates or the whole vector can be expanded in the formal power series in H bar. And the well-known fact is that this formal expansion is resurgent. So it is this formal series, divergent formal series, a priori divergent series, they are Borel resummable. All right, so then summarizing from the question? No? From the exponential integral, we can construct a holomorphic vector bundle on C star. In fact, it can be extended to C. And we can construct a section of this holomorphic vector bundle, and the coordinates of this section, the formal series in Stokes sectors, which are resurgent. So this is kind of a more general phenomenon. It's more general than just about exponential integrals. And this slide is devoted.
Maybe I do have a question.
Uh-huh.
In what generality is this supposed to be true? The function of what kind?
What generality of what? What was
what
on the previous?
Things are resurgent.
So, for example, like the generality which I mentioned, X is, say, I don't know, smooth complex algebraic variety, F is an affine function on it. This is it.
We're asking have arbitrary critical
numbers? No. I mentioned that Morse. But what's on this slide? So you see, my son tells me that I'm trying to put too much on one slide, and this is a good example. That yes, indeed. But it's something about the conceptual reason for the resurgence, which supposed to be true in a much bigger generality. This more general reason was discussed in our paper in 2020, which was devoted to analytic wall crossing structures. And this story in Maxim's talk today, it was about a very special case of analytic wall crossing structure, even more than just analytic, but in particular analytic. In the story, the kind of specialization of the general story to exponential integrals, it's a wall crossing structure which is defined by the data, which is a local system of graded Lie algebras on C star or on the circle. And this local system of graded Lie algebras, gamma graded, gamma is on the slide, it's just z in the power of critical values. It's a Lie algebra of vector fields on the torus of characters and some additional data. So when we have this wall crossing structure, then we showed that it gives rise to a formal scheme which contains inside a field of projective lines. And analyticity, it just, you see one paragraph for 60 pages of that paper. Analyticity of the wall crossing structure means that this formal scheme comes from a complex analytic one. So this is a general theory developed in that paper, and we formulated the general resurgent conjecture in that paper. Namely, we explained how to out of an analytic wall crossing structure, how one construct a certain holomorphic fiber bundle over C star with the fiber which is given by this torus of characters. And so the resurgence conjecture says that holomorphic sections of this fiber bundle gives rise to Taylor series which are resurgent. So if we start with exponential integral, we have such a fiber bundle, and in fact, we can consider even a vector bundle, not necessarily a fiber bundle. And so then whatever I mentioned on the previous slide, which actually a fact, it was proved, although I'm not sure what's a good reference for that, this resurgence of finite dimensional exponential integrals with Mohr's phase, it's a special case of this more general conjecture. And this conjecture gives an exponential conceptual reason. And so that's answering, I think it's Vivek's question about kind of generalization to kind of more general functions F. Again, if you can show that the arising wall crossing structure is analytic, so then, and if this conjecture is true, and it's very plausible conjecture, we illustrated it in many examples, then you should have resurgence. All right, so this is it. This is the end of the finite dimensional story. So, and now I am going to kind of more shaky part, our proposal in the infinite dimensional case. So are there any questions about the first part? All right. So ideally in the second part, I should also consider an arbitrary complex symplectic manifold with two holomorphic Lagrangian submanifolds. These holomorphic Lagrangians will be boundary, will give the boundary conditions for certain Feynman integral. So just kind of to be more concrete, let's assume that M is just a standard symplectic vector space. And so we are looking at this ill-defined Feynman integral with a certain action function S of phi or some ill-defined measure, not specified integration cycles. Everything, of course, has to be explained if you want to treat it seriously. But the point is that we will try to kind of avoid these foundational difficulties in the way which I explain. So a few things which can be defined. One is a space of paths. So if I take two smooth holomorphic Lagrangians, I consider the space of paths phi smooth maps from the interval 0, 1, such that one endpoint belongs to L0, another one belongs to L1. There is a closed to form. Let's So that's, it's kind of infinite dimensional complex symplectic manifold. And so let's assume that the action functional is holomorphic. So then it's kind of infinite dimensional generalization of the setup which we discussed previously. And what is written, this Feynman integral, it should be thought of as infinite dimensional generalization of what we considered previously. Now, quantum mechanically, this is an example of the functional S of phi. Now, critical points are essentially intersection of two holomorphic Lagrangians, which one is a given one and the other one is obtained by the Hamiltonian flow from L0. So then this intersection points, they are critical points of S, and now there can be infinitely many of them, say countably many, like for holomorphic Chern-Simons, for example. So then morally we are in the same framework as we were in the finite dimensional story, with the only thing that the very object is not well defined. Now, kind of what is the motivation? So let's think of the Feynman integral as, again, as an isomorphism of the global Deram and global Bethe cohomology by analogy, both ill-defined. So then the sum over critical points, for example, like flat connection for the complexified Chern-Simons, it can be interpreted as a sort of a composition of the global Deram and global Bethe with the local isomorphism. So, which means that we kind of can represent the global integral as a sum of local inputs, sum of inputs of critical points. In the finite dimensional case, they were integrals over local thimbles, symbols outcoming of critical points of our holomorphic function. So here is the kind of a similar story, if you'd like. And so the problem now of kind of making sense of this ill-defined object splits into two. First, to give a meaning of the local expressions, like local, like integrals over local symbols, and then glue them together using some kind of Stokes automorphisms. This is how we, what we did in the finite dimensional case. In that case, as I explained, we solved some Riemann-Hilbert problem. And so then first we would like to make sense for each critical point of this formal expansion. And so what's in the bracket, as you should expect, it should be for some general reasons, resurgent. And so this is what kind of, this is a goal. And let me explain the idea. I mean, from physics perspective, it's kind of very natural, because quantum mechanically, we can think of the Feynman integral as a matrix element of the exponent of the quantized Hamiltonian for two quantum wave functions assigned to the boundary conditions, one assigned to L0, and which is a holomorphic Lagrangian, and the other, C1, is assigned to L1, which is another holomorphic Lagrangian. And H bar is a quantization of our Hamiltonian. Even the topological case, when there is no Hamiltonian at all, is already interesting. Because what we have to do, we have to give a meaning of the pairing of two quantum wave functions. We need to say what they are, and we have to give a meaning of this scalar product. And the idea is that the quantum wave functions can be defined in terms of holomorphic in terms of deformation quantization. And in order to give meaning of this pairing, we will use our Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, which involves the Fleur theory of L0 and L1. This is easier to do, and probably I will do it in for the case of explain this for the case of the trivial Hamiltonian. In the trivial one, the situation is a little bit more complicated because Hamiltonian should be used in order to transport the quantum wave function C0, and only after the along the Hamiltonian floor, and take the scalar product with C1 only after this transport. All right, now kind of a reminder, or if you'd like, crash course on the basics of deformation quantization, because it's a workshop rather on Fleur theory than on deformation quantization. So I need to say something. So if we start with a holomorphic symplectic manifold, then we can associate with a sheaf of, say, abelian categories of, say, deformation quantization modules, which is not necessarily a sheaf of modules or some sheaf of algebras. It's a stack. It's a sheaf of categories. But under some assumptions, which I don't want even to discuss, the category of global sections is a category of finite type modules over some associative algebra quantization, like star product quantization of M. And this is what I will assume. Of course, skipping maybe kind of tons of pages written by people about the possibility indeed to have this algebra. Now, from physics perspective, this quantized algebra of H bar of M probably should be called a canonical coisotropic brain. It interacts with, for example, with the Lagrangian brain in the following way. If one can assign to a Lagrangian complex Lagrangian submanifold a module, then we just take home from this canonical coisotropic brain to this module. And now, in order to do this, again, it's a work of many people, most notably by Agnola, Kashiwara, and Shapira. And the fact is that if we take the complex Lagrangian submanifold and choose the square root of the canonical bundle, then we can assign to it an object in the category of modules over this algebra. In fact, this object belongs to a smaller category of holonomic modules, which means that in certain sense it's supported on this Lagrangian. Well, the easiest way to say that it's holomorphic is to take its reduction modulo H bar, but the problem is that in order to define this object, one has to invert H bar. Nevertheless, these foundational difficulties can be resolved, and they were resolved. Another difficulty which has not been resolved in general is the possibility to consider H bar as a complex number rather than a parameter. In sometimes, for example, for ordinary D modules or for QD modules, it can be done. And so I will assume in order to explain the idea, I will assume that h bar can be fixed. So basically we have families, in fact, analytic families, in fact, analytic families of abelian A infinity category. So there are some words which you will see when our paper will appear in the archive, but nevertheless, intuitively, we have families of abelian categories depending on the complex, say non-zero complex number h bar. All right. Now, what's the idea? I have still a few minutes, so I can illustrate the idea about kind of defining in these terms the local input of the critical point of the action functional. So let's look at these two lines of linear maps. So L0 and L1 are Lagrangian complex holomorphic Lagrangian submanifolds. And let's choose square roots of the canonical bundles, which we have to do in order to define these objects, EL0 and EL1. These are holomorphic holonomic DQ modules. But we can consider X groups in the bigger category, in the category of all DQ modules, because this canonical coisotropic brain, it's not supported on the Lagrangian submanifold. It has full support on N. And so this, so that the first line is just a standard map of X groups. But then we can pass to the second line using this Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, first global and then local. And then when we are in the Fukaya category, in the local Fukaya category, it carries a Calabi-Yau structure. So we can pair and construct a series. So for technical reason, it's h bar in the power 1/2. I believe that if L0 and L1 are not transversal, it can be some more general rational numbers. Now, elements of this group, let's call them left quantum wave function. Elements of this one are called right quantum L function, wave functions. And so then in the end, we have the pairing between left and right. So that's the idea. This is a proposal in kind of in abstract terms. You see, because in the end we get some formal power series. All right. Now, what this structure mean axiomatically? So what, for example, if we are working in the framework of the category of holonomic modules and in terms of the in framework of Fukaya categories, what we should kind of, what objects we should fix. So first of all, we should fix this element which encodes the volume form, and then we should fix this element which encodes the integration cycle. Now, if you want to speak about the formal expansion, this input of the critical point, then what we are talking about is the following. We apply the Riemann-Hilbert correspondent to this, if you'd like, volume form. Of course, by the volume form, I mean the volume form multiplied by the exponent of my action functional, and then pair it with the Betti cycle. So basically just an abstract form of the local integral, but if we have this data, then this is some finite dimensional data, because the category of holonomic DQ modules, it's something like category of D modules. And So it's everything is finite dimension. And so then we have the answer, and this is a proposal. Now, since my time is up and there are too many pages to explain, let me just say that in order to make this kind of even more precise, I need to explain what is a quantum wave function. And this is an interesting story by itself. It's in the title of my talk. This can be done using the methods of Gelfand-Kasdan formal differential geometry. But I believe that I don't have time for that. I can, of course, kind of browse through the remaining slides, and I understand that all of them are posted in the chat, and so you can read them. But this is an example of the very concrete how these wave functions look kind of in coordinates in C to N. This is something which is very well familiar for people, for example, in the theory of WKB approximations. And so what we have in the end, indeed, we have some well-crossing structure which is expected to be analytic. And so then the formal series which were on kind of on one of the previous slides. Let's go back. Yeah, here this formal series well should be a resurgent for general general reasons. So it's more general than just, for example, holomorphic Chern-Simons, but in particular, it's most interesting to apply it to Chern-Simons because it fits perfectly to this framework. Like if you have three-dimensional, say, compact manifold, take a knot inside, take a tubular neighborhood, and so you can construct two holomorphic Lagrangians. So then everything fits to this general framework. All right, so this is it. So should I ask, are there any questions?
So I have two questions. One is, is there like any instance in which you can prove that this wall crossing structure is in fact analytic?
Well, first of all, for the exponential integrals, yes, it was proved. Now, one thing, let me kind of explain why kind of the sort of a straightforward way to prove it in a big generality. If you have two holomorphic Lagrangians, in the complex symplectic manifold, you can rescale the holomorphic symplectic forms by this H bar. So then sometimes for some Stokes directions, these pseudo holomorphic disks appear. And so you can virtually count them. So if you have an exponential bound on the virtual number of pseudo holomorphic disks, then the wall crossing structure will be analytic. Yeah, the very definition of the wall crossing analyticity of the wall crossing structure, it's pretty abstract, as I told you. First, you define some formal scheme, and then when this formal scheme can be analytified, when it comes from analytic, complex analytic, then your wall crossing structure is analytic. So it's kind of very difficult to check it directly. But if you have this exponential bounds on what should be called like Donaldson Thomas invariants, in general, then the wall crossing structures are analytic. But for finite dimensional exponential integrals, we have just finitely many, this finitely many, these numbers nij integers, they are finite, and so yeah, you can prove it.
And I had another question about just this basic so I understood in the infinite, in the finite dimensional case, you begin life with a global isomorphism, and using that global isomorphism, you can deduce that you know, like these wall crossings will be computed by some count of Stokes, whatever. But what I didn't understand in the infinite dimensional case, you then have a priori some kind of a global such isomorphism, or is the situation that you have the local isomorphisms and then you declare that you patch them together with the Stokes data, which you define by counting holomorphic disks?
Yeah, the second one. Like a kind of toy model. Like imagine that it's Chern-Simons story with a compact group. First you complexify it, yeah. So then you have this holomorphic story. Then using this deformation quantization stuff, you define local inputs. So the whole thing as a formal will be sum over critical points of the flat connections. And each series, each local input is defined in terms of deformation quantization. This is something which kind of theoretically can be done. Now you have some formal series in H bar, and you want to construct a finite dimensional, if you'd like, or kind of manageable, maybe countable dimensional vector bundle over C star. So, and the idea is the same. You should kind of solve some Riemann-Hilbert problems. So your series enjoys some, so, I mean, when if these Riemann-Hilbert problems are solved, then you can glue a holomorphic bundle just for general reasons. So then the approach is that first you indeed start with some local thing, and then you define global by solving Riemann-Hilbert problem, which involves, of course, it's not an easy task, I believe, because I think for Chern-Simons, you should, if you want to prove analyticity, you should have exponential bounds on the number of probably this number of gradient lines. It's basically a solution to Kapustin-Witten equation in four dimensions. So, but theoretically, I mean, again, you deal with something finite dimensional. As long as you have these numbers, Donaldson-Thomas invariants, you have some Riemann-Hilbert problem essentially in finite dimension.
In order to define what Riemann-Hilbert problem you're solving, what input do you need? You need to know?
Yeah, you need, yeah, correct. You need to have some non-trivial piece of information, but you need it anyway. You need this Donaldson-Thomas invariants in the case of finite dimensional exponential integrals, kind of the toy model. Yeah, you see, you need this Nij. If you don't have them, then there is no Riemann-Hilbert problem. In infinite dimensions, you also need some input, Donaldson-Thomas invariants. But if you have them, then, yeah, I'm not saying that I have solved the problem. So this is a framework, a general framework in which you can state the problem, and probably sometimes you can solve it. So you don't need, for example, to develop the, I don't know, like the Floyer theory of semi-infinite cycles. Like if you try to approach these Feynman integrals literally by analogy with finite dimensional case. So we can avoid it. Yeah. Instead,
why do you say it's Kapustin-Witten as opposed to the usual instanton equation?
Basically, you should count the number of gradient trajectories between critical points, between, say, flat connections for the rescaled, complexified Chern-Simons functional. Actually, lifted to the universal cover because universal abelian cover because it's multi-dimensional, it's multi-valued, yeah. So it's quite complicated, but nevertheless, it's some kind of, it's classical problem. It's not the quantum problem. Let me say it this way. You have some maybe huge complex manifold. Well, maybe kind of infinite dimensional. You have a function, holomorphic function. You have critical points, or more generally, maybe even create some critical loci in it, and you count the number of, say, gradient lines from one critical locus to another one. Of course, it's a complicated problem, but it's a classical problem, yeah? Because you have some geometric objects and you count lines between two components, blah, blah, blah. It's a difficult, but it's a classical problem. But in the end, you give a meaning of some quantum integral, yeah.
Other questions? If not, let's thank Jan for the nice talk. And so we'll proceed in the afternoon at 2 with a talk by Sergei Gukov. Thank you.